Enjoy it.
All right, thank you.
Go for it. The meeting is called back to order at 9:15. Thank you. Item 4, consideration of consent items. A, consider and take action regarding approving minutes from regular board meeting held September 17, 2015. B, consider and take action regarding... Okay. Consider and take action. B. Consider and take action regarding approving minutes from the special board meeting held on September 16th and September 23rd, 2015.
Pull.
C. Consider and take action regarding approving monthly financial information as of October 31st, 2015. D. Consider and take action regarding approving amendments to the budget for 2016 fiscal year. E. Consider and take action regarding approving of expenditures equal to or greater than $50,000. F. Consider and take action regarding approving the Judson Independent School District's annual financial audit report for fiscal year 2015. G. Consider and take action regarding approving the 2015 tax roll for the Judson Independent School District. H. Consider and take action regarding approving request for qualifications 16-04 for special education professional services. I. Consider and take action regarding approving request for proposal 16-06 for an electronic student response system. J. Consider what you want to pull. Take I. Consider and take action regarding approving the campus improvement plan executive summary reports. Pulled by Ms. Bishop. That was A. Okay. B is pulled, yes. Okay. K. Consider and take action regarding approving policy update 102 affecting local policies, second reading. 1. CDA local, other revenues, investments. 2. DBB local, employment requirements and restrictions, medical examinations, and communicable diseases. 3. DEA local, compensation and benefits, compensation plan. DEA local, compensation plan, incentives, and stipends. 5. DEAB local, compensation plan, wages and hourly and hour laws, wage and hour laws. 6. DFFA local, reduction in force, financial exigency. 7. DAT local, employee standards of conduct, searches in alcohol / drug testing. 8. FNC local, student rights and responsibilities, student conduct. 9. FO local, student discipline. Okay, we'll be voting on A, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, and K. All those in favor say aye.
Motion.
Motion, I'm sorry. Okay. Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Macias. Second. Mr. LaFall, second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, we're going to go to B. Consider and take action regarding approving minutes from the special board meetings held on September 16th and September 23rd, 2015.
Second.
Motion by Mr. LaFall, second by Mr. Macias. Mr. Salinas, you please.
Yes,
individually on that minute first.
Okay, you want to amend the motion to?
Yes, I'd like to amend the motion that we vote, that we take action on the September 16th, approving the minutes for the meeting on September 16th.
Right.
Before we do the 27th. That's for right, the 27th?
23rd.
Okay.
Second?
Second.
Okay. The amended motion that we separate the two dates, voting first on September 16th, seconded by Mr. Macias. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay. Motion carries. So we are not.
That was a motion to separate the minutes.
Separate the minutes.
Yeah, to separate the minutes.
Okay. Okay. Consider and take action regarding approving minutes for the, from the special board meetings held on September 16th.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Yes. I have a question. I'm certain one of our committee members, Mr. England, mentioned about not approving the minutes. I know it's symbolic in a sense, but I do kind of agree with that. For the first part, I did not suggest Dr. Mackey and it's stated in the minutes. I suggested Christopher Balthasar, which was, of course, correct. I went ahead and just, for the sake of moving the meeting along, agreed with Dr. Mackey. But the minutes say that I suggested Willis Mackey, but did not. So I would like that reflected accurately. On the 16th on the minutes, it says that I suggested and I did not. My first suggestion was Christopher Balthasar. And so I will admit I voted for it. I've been very accountable in terms of how that went down, but I want to be very clear. And secondly, that's fine, but I have a contest on that, so I'd like that to be reworded. And then the last part is I won't support them in a symbolic gesture, as Mr. England has stated that we don't have to approve the minutes, and perhaps that's another way to protest the direction of the government.
Anybody else? Okay, the vote is to accept, consider and take action regarding approving the minutes from the special board meeting held on September 16th. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
Okay. They're not approved. Mr. Salina, Mr. Macias, Mr. Lafoil, and Dr. Salina. Thank you. Okay, item J. Consider and take action regarding approving minutes, item B, the second part. Approving minutes from the special board meeting held on September 23rd, 2015. Do I have a motion? Motion by Mr. Salinas, second by Mr. Macias. Discussion. Being no discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. Item J. Consider and take action regarding approving campus improvement plan executive summary report. Do I have a motion?
Second.
Motion by Ms. Pichal, second by Mr. Salinas. Discussion. Ms. Pichal.
All right, as I was going through these summaries, the first thing that I noticed is an inconsistency in the format. So I have to assume, if I'm directing this to Dr. Montoya, that there was no particular format in order for the campuses to follow to do this summary.
There was a discussion with the principals to try to standardize it with Ms. Barrow and Ms.
Yes, there was a certain format of some requirements that they had to have in the school, they had to have in the principal. They had to talk about their scores, they had to talk about their goals and what the focus was. And And some of them chose to do it all, some in charge, others just to wrap it up. Well, my question is that some of them are very specific in how they're going to accomplish their goals. Others are not. So my question is, for those campuses that do not specify in their focus, how they're going to accomplish it, how are they going to?
I can tell you that. I have gone through every single one of them. I have given them feedback. Some of them were submitted their revisions, but we have already turned in their reports to the board.
So when will we see the revisions this year?
You can have it at the next board meeting, Mr. Schwartz.
Thank you. For some of them, they need to show the process in which they're going to accomplish the goals that they said that they're going to. So that's what I'll be looking for.
Yes, ma'am. You have it at the next board meeting.
Anyone else?
Dr. Fulmer.
I just have a quick question. Many of the campuses listed PLCs, which are professional learning communities, research-based by Richard and Rebecca Dufour. There is one school or maybe two that mentioned systems, and just want to know, are we being consistent throughout the district, so are we doing professional learning communities research-based, or are we doing a system at one school and not?
One of the things that we have told the principals is that the systems is the process that we use to conduct our PLCs at the schools. If some of them went through a system, you have an oversight because every single principal of the West Director that all the systems are really PLCs because we're adding more components to it.
So maybe in the revisions that you will get?
We will definitely make sure that they all reflect PLCs.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, we're going to vote on item J, consider and take action regarding approving campus improvement plan and executive summary report.
I'd like to amend the motion that we will consider and take action on the campus improvement plans after we receive the revisions from the new plans.
Yes, I'd like one question. So these have to be in the area or are these just for the board?
No, this is localized.
Would you all support pulling it until the December meeting when we have
I can do that.
Not vote. We're not going to vote against it until December.
Right.
Is that okay?
Absolutely. I'll withdraw the amendment and defer it for December.
the ones that you have questions on. If you give me the names that you have questions on, okay. If you do that, I can make sure. Okay. Very good. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, sir. We're going to pull on and enjoy it until next month. So, first consent item now. Action items. Discussion and consideration of action items. Number 5. A. Consider and take possible action regarding approval of a budget amendment for the district's portion of E-rate approved technology infrastructure project. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Motion, Mr. Macias. Second, Mr. LaForce. Discussion. Mr. Macias.
Yes, I inquired about this particular motion, a budget amendment. It's almost nearing $1 million. And so the question I had asked to Dr. Montoya was if we could put this on a future bond. Obviously, we're going to use some M&O money to pay for it, but that if this amount could go to a future bond to kind of offset our expenses. And I was told if you don't want to explain the answer, Dr. Montoya, I'll
explain. Go ahead, Mr. Montoya.
Sure. Thank you. If it's the board's desire that this item come out of a future bond, then in next month or the month after, we can bring out a resolution to the board, a reimbursement resolution, to approve that, and then we'll have it available for us and that flexibility will exist. So if the next bond is approved, then we can reimburse the general fund for the suspension.
My opinion of it was that we may have a proposition for infrastructure improvements, so it would just come out of that proposition for infrastructure improvements, right?
Yes, that is correct. And in essence, we would be, completing these projects now. And this item, just so everyone knows, is we're spending $1 million for $3 million of the projects. So those $1 million will be paid by this fund, by the E-rate fund. So yes, you're okay.
Exactly. It's definitely a good buy that $1 million will go back into the classroom of factor, and that would be a good thing. So what did you say needed to happen? We need to have
at the next board meeting, we can prepare a reimbursement resolution to present to the board, which y'all can discuss. And if you vote for it, then we will have it available when we do and pass the next bond to reimburse the general fund for that.
Mr. Lizondo, how much have we put into the, depending if we pass the bond? I know we've done that.
Well, there is. We have several reimbursement resources that are available to us that we've passed in the past. The largest one is for the funds that were transferred to Union High School because we wanted to increase the scope of the first phase. And so we transferred a total of $4.4 million. So that money, when the bond gets passed to complete the high school, then $4.4 million will be reimbursed back to the general fund out of those bond proceeds because we're spending that money now out of the general fund. In addition to that, we have another reimbursement resolution that we can recoup the funds for the land that we purchased for the elementary school site. So the one we purchased so far is $1 million. So if we build an elementary on that site, we can recover $1 million of that and bring it back to the general fund. And then we also, as y'all are aware, we created the Jefferson ISD Public Facility Corporation, which borrowed $6.2 million for Kirby Middle School to build a building that was damaged by fire. So that's another item that we're going to be asking for to transfer. And that was a little different in that we're not going to move that money to the general fund, but the general fund is obligated to pay those funds. So what would happen is that we would now move that obligation that was approved by the voters from the general fund to the deficit fund, so it would be paid by a different tax source. So we free up those payments, if you will, for $6.2 million plus interest away from the general fund and over to the deficit fund. And those are the major ones. There's a few smaller ones, but those are the major ones. So, approximately, yes, sir.
And our fund balance right now is sitting at about $41, $42 million.
The general operating unassigned fund balance is right now, I guess, at $42 million.
I think we should consider maybe taking out the general fund. We have that much fund balance and then not be banking. Let's say a bond doesn't pass, for 3, 4, 5 years, then you're committed, to.
Just to be clear, if the board approves this item, that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to take this money out of the general operating fund balance for now. And If the board wants us to do a resolution, we can do that, present to the board. And when we sell the bonds, just because the board has approved the resolution, doesn't mean we have to take the money. At that time, it can be decided that, hey, you know what, our general fund balance is fine. We don't want to take that reimbursement. And you just take the money in bond fund, and in essence, the general fund just picks up the expense. But it would be up to the board to decide how they want to handle it at that time. It would just give you the flexibility to do it if you wanted to do it.
How far are we over on our fund balance? Let's say usually 3 months operating, and you know, it comes to a point where if you have too much in fund balance, you know, let's say, hey, you know, let's reduce what we're taking in, or let's cut taxes or something. Where are we in that zone?
Well, the board policy that was adopted a few years ago says that we're supposed to have 17% fund balance based on our operating for the general operating fund, which that equates to about $35 million right now based on current expenditures. So out of that $42 million, we have a little bit of room there, but there are some items that are going to be coming to the board. For instance, I know the board has expressed that, I know that you're all aware that we're trying to purchase another piece of land right now, and so the board expresses some board members have that they like to bring another resolution to the board saying we want to keep and replenish that reserve that we have for land for $3 million. So we will take out of that $42 million, we will take $3 million out of that, again, to designate for land for future purchases, so we kind of have it up earmarked. And at the next board meeting, I know that there is an item that's going to be coming forward for buses, to purchase buses and replacement over the replacement cycle. And that's going to be, you know, anywhere between $1.5 to $2 million, depending on the number of buses that we are going to purchase for. And I'm thinking there's one other item. There's a few personnel items that's maybe $600,000 to $700,000. And some of those are for the new school, to make sure we have the administrators and things like that coming on board. And when we're looking at the budget for the new school and at the, what we call the FF&E budget for the furniture and equipment budget, we're accumulating all those requests. And from what I can tell right now, we may be coming to the board and saying we're going to need anywhere between $1 to $1.5 million to make sure that we equip that school properly. So we'll just kind of keep those in the back of your mind, just kind of thinking about that we will be coming forward and requesting some of those items here in the near future. And of course, it's up to the board. Like the $3 million, if you don't want us to earmark it, then we don't have to do that. Some of the items we may not have as much flexibility because we definitely need the buses. We're going to need to equip the new school for some of them. So just to kind of some things that we're going to have to bring this school.
Any other discussion? Mr. Salinas.
Mr. President, question, Dr. Montoya. On this budget amendment, actually, we're looking at $3.1 million. Is that correct?
No, sir. The budget amendment is for $992,063. That's the district's portion of this project. So, altogether, that $3.1 million is how much we're going to get to build, if you will, an infrastructure. $3.1 million, but it's only going to cost the district $992,000. The other $2 million is coming from the integrated program, which is a grant of people.
Thank you very much.
That is a good deal. You know, you can't pass that, you know. And I'm not trying to throw water on it. I'm just saying on the resolution side, if we're going to cover out of fund balance, the general fund, or we're going to, you know, we can always take the resolution, but like you said, we don't have to.
That's correct.
Okay, anybody else? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item B. Consider and take possible action regarding approving ballot cast for Bexar County Bexar Appraisal Board District Board of Directors casting 199 votes by resolution. Do I have a motion?
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. LaFleur, second by Mr. Salinas. Discussion.
You said it's for how many votes?
199.
How come you said 196 for Tux? What did we get
199? I'm just reading what's on here.
For my program, sir?
Mr. Montoya, it should be 199.
Okay, that's correct. So 196 plus 199.
Yes. And that's what the board would select the candidates at the end.
We can, right.
believe our recommendation was brought forward by Southwest ISD, Mr. Main. So we will be casting our vote for the final 199 votes. Any more discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion carries. C. Consider and take possible action regarding approving the appointment of the three community members for the Justin ISD Hall of Honor Selection Committee. Well, second.
Second.
Motion, Mr. LaFleur, second. Mr. Salinas. Discussion. Mr. LaFleur.
Are we going to change the criteria for this year, or are we going to wait on next year? Mr. Livingston, if you'll step up, a committee was formed at the request of the board to look at another area to honor the community people and human service to the district. But Mr. Livingston, you want to share that?
Well, yes. The selection committee has had a discussion about this on and off for about the past 5 months ago. And as you can see in the next item after this, the criteria is we've got some recommendations for the board to look at. Now, as far as the criteria is concerned, the selection committee that was made up of myself, the three high school principals, and Mr. Merrill, the consensus was is that if the recommendations were approved by the board, they would kick in next year. Because at that point, when we had started the process of changing the criteria recommendations, we were in the throes of submission process already. Those folks that were submitting their nominations were looking at the criteria as it was standing at that time and basing their submissions on that criteria as it was at that point. Now, as far as another Hall of Honor category, we could certainly look at a category that included those folks that gave significant service to the district that did not graduate from the district. That could be another Hall of Honor category if the board would like to consider that. That is not in the current recommendations that we have before you tonight, but we can certainly look at that and put together some other criteria that would go along with that category. Now, as the recommendations stand this evening, we have the Civic Hall of Honor having included those people who both were graduates of Judson ISD and those who were not.
So they're included.
So they would be included in the recommendations that we are right now putting forth before the board. But again, the consensus by the committee at that time was that since the submission process had already started, that these recommendations, if they were passed by the board, would kick in the next year for whenever we have submissions picked back up. As far as the community members are concerned, those were to come from the board members.
To suggest the brief page of the survey.
typically the selection is made this month or early December.
Okay.
Because there has to be time, first of all, for us to notify the people who are going to be inducted. We have to have plaques that have been made, pictures either taken of these individuals or, some way so that we can put their picture up on the plaque.
So, Mr. Macias, your recommendation, he's from the Judson area, I believe?
Mr. Yes.
District 1. And Mr. LaFleur, Sonny Merrill, is from the Judson area. He's in Live Oak.
I'm not sure where Mr. Sonny Merrill is living.
I believe he lives in Live Oak.
Well, he's here. I saw him outside. He probably can verify his location. So, I think he's in the back.
There he comes, as we speak.
So, Sonny, are you in the Judson area?
No. In the Judson High School?
What area?
No. What high school area?
Wagner.
Okay.
No,
District 2.
Two or three, wherever you are.
The recommendations for what, sir? They began, I have to go back and look exactly when the submission for, or solicitation for submissions started, but I believe it was the first part of October, and it ended November the 3rd.
But now I'm hearing we have three proposed community members, one from Wagner, one from Judson, and the other one from Judson. And that's the way we work that.
Yes, I'd like to ask Mr. Lee some questions. Was the nomination period extended?
It was extended beyond the month of October for a couple of days, just so that we could have a certain number of days that the submission process could be done, so that people would be given a good, good period of time to make submissions. There is a bit of a process when a person makes a submission, because it's not just putting a name, on the electronic form or however they want to do it. You have to kind of give a little bit of a background on the individual so that the selection committee can look at it, see if this is somebody that, has done some significant, has some significant history, and then make their decision.
So what the board is going to be doing is, when the committee comes to the board, we're going to approve or disapprove those nominations, correct?
Yes, ma'am. They will.
So the board can make their own, your committee, I'm sorry. Your committee can make your own decision as to when you meet, when you get together, when you decide, and then when you bring us the recommendation. That is what that committee has the autonomy of doing, correct?
Yes, ma'am. Over the past couple of years, because the time for selection has been compressed, in past years, sometimes the committee has actually met physically. Other times, they have communicated through email, and then they have emailed their thumbs up or thumbs down on each one of the nominees.
So either one of those ways, you all will get together and make that decision.
Yeah, the committee does. I'm not part of the selection committee, but yes, that committee does make the recommendation.
Yes.
It goes before the board, and then the board takes action.
Otherwise, the committee has autonomy to handle their business in their way.
That's as I understand it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Linscombe, how long do these committee members serve?
They serve 1 year.
Okay.
During that particular submission process. And then either the same individuals can be renominated and serve again, or we can certainly have someone new.
And I noticed that it says the criteria can be reviewed and changed annually. Is that by the committee members, or is that by the board?
The criteria?
It says the criteria can be reviewed and changed annually. It's under the Athletic Hall of Honor. And it's not under the civic one. But who's in charge of making those changes?
The board can make the changes to the criteria. That's the reason why we've got these recommendations before the board this evening.
For the next item on your agenda, right?
Yes.
Okay. And do the committee members have a rubric that they use? Do we have a copy of that rubric? How do they select the members? Only because we want to make sure we're clear on who we're nominating and then what happens.
Basically, the rubric is they look at the submissions. They take a look at what is written. They discuss it. Among themselves, through communication, and they make the decision from that point. There is not anything in terms of a true rubric that you're looking for in terms of how they make that decision. Now, if that is something that the board wants to line out and have guidelines on, that can certainly. But as far as whenever I came into the district and I started to handle the Hall of Honor, that was basically the selection process.
And how many nominees have you received?
This year?
Yes.
We have, in terms of submissions, because sometimes you have more than one submission for nominating.
Correct.
As long as, they can have one or ten. We have, I believe, 13.
13 nominees.
That's total. I'll have to go back and check to make sure, but that's what we have. Ever since we started doing the advertisement in the Herald, we started doing the email blast to district personnel. We've begun to have more response and more engagement into this particular.
Do you know how many from each category? So how many are athletic and how many are civic of those 13?
No, I do not.
Okay.
Yes, thank you. I recall asking that question last month, Dr. Simmons, because, with all of the attention that's being given to the numerics with naming the high school, and I think attention needs to be given to a rubric for this Hall of Honor. It just seems too arbitrary, and we want to be fair. So I'm gonna support that there is a rubric that the committee would be taxed with coming up with, so that they can make a fair and educated and intellectual decision on Hall of Honor inductees.
Okay, yeah, we'll go to the next slide. But, Mr. Lipscomb, do you facilitate making sure these people get to work on this? It's a committee of three for this period, this time period.
For the criteria, or are you talking about the selection process?
For the selection.
I get them the contact information everybody needs in order to get a hold of each other. They make their own time in terms of meeting times and so forth. I basically facilitate so that they can get in touch with each other, and I let them do that. And then they let me know in terms of the votes, and I to tally things up, but the process is theirs.
Okay. Anybody else? Any more discussion? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. D. Consider and take possible action regarding approving revisions to the Hall of Honor criteria. Motion, Ms. LaFleur. Second, Ms. Pashaw. Discussion. I think we discussed it.
Yeah, I think you're right. We did discuss it.
One question I have on this is, you say the committee will set the criteria, redo the criteria, but the committee is only in place for the selection of the candidates to be placed in the hall.
There's a selection committee and then there's a criteria committee. Okay, the criteria committee, which is still in place, is the three high school principals, myself and Mr. Merrill. The other committee, which the board is now putting forth the names for the selection committee. That's another group.
Okay. Now, we're planning this for next year's selection, right?
The criteria?
Yes.
Yes.
The criteria for next year's selection. Any other discussion? Mr. Shaw?
If it is up to the committee to set the criteria, then why can't this become effective immediately for a non-Jetson graduate?
For the committee's recommendations for the board to take action on, where the committee does not set the criteria, because they're obviously not the governing body. But it is a group that comes together to make the recommendations for the board, and the board takes action on it one way or the other.
Again, this is something that I brought up before when it was within your window of time, that I didn't see any reason why one small little item could not be put into effect or brought to the board for us to vote on, so that it would be effective immediately for any non-Jetson graduates who have served for many years in volunteering their services to our district.
Well, I understand the committee made the recommendation because the submission process at that time, which is the basis for people to make submissions, had already been out there. And so we felt like that would not be fair to those that are submitting to change, so to speak, horses in midstream. So that we all made the submissions during a time when the rules and the criteria were set, and then the next year, whenever submissions picked back up again, then we would start with the new set of rules, make sure that everybody knew about them, and that it's a new opportunity for people to make their submissions.
Yes, sir, I understand. However, you did say you extended it. And you extended it without board approval, did you not?
Well, there has never been a period of time necessarily that has been lined out for that submission process. In fact, the submission process could, that could be whatever we want it to be, I suppose. I mean, there's nothing lined out there.
That's why I'm saying that small thing could be extended. If it's already been extended, it could still be extended so that the criteria could be changed to be effective immediately. That's all I'm saying.
Dr. Salinas.
Thank you. I saw that you made some changes that we requested, in particular in the selection committee for the Civic Hall of Honor. If you could, I don't know what page it's on for you, but page 147, that talks about the selection committee. The very last sentence at the top, this committee will also evaluate Civic Hall of Honor nominees. I'm guessing that should have been just eliminated, and it was not, because you're talking about the athletic Hall of Honor?
Yes, that just needs to be done.
Correct, so that last sentence needs to be eliminated. And then in the next bullet, if an individual or team has not been selected for the Hall after 7 nominations, that individual or team is no longer eligible for approval. Should that be 7 years of nominations?
Well, there's a difference between submissions.
Correct.
And there's a difference between and nominations. So if a person gets 1 or 10 submissions, they're only going to be nominated 1 time that year. So in other words, if a person's nominated, has 7 nominations and they do not make it, then they are at that point ineligible.
I just think that when people give a name, they don't consider it a submission, they consider it a nomination. I just want to be clear on that it's not 7 nominations. I mean, I understand what you're saying, but again, I want to be transparent and clear and have something that's very clear to the public so that they don't think, oh, we got 50 people to nominate Mr. LaFoyle to submit his name. I want to be real clear. So I don't know if that should be 7 years, 7 nominations. I don't know. I think that wording could be worked on.
We can certainly change that to years.
So then the next bullet says...
If you feel like that's clear.
But he's calling them submissions.
Those are submissions.
So that's
a nominee can be a nominee, whether they get 1 submission a year or they get 20 submissions. So if it's the same person, then they're a nominee. For however many submissions they get, they are nominees.
So maybe it should say after their name has been submitted 7 different times or years. Thank you. Just something, not something to work on, but if you could work on that. Yes. And then back to Ms. Cashals, we have to have a rubric. Because for the civic, you're talking about leadership in Judson. Well, what does that mean? What are the qualities of a leader? Responsibility and integrity towards Judson. I don't know how you rate that, right? How do you measure that? Thank you, Mr. Shaw. So, and I know this is for next year, and I'm fine with that. Just so we can have it. And then see how the athletic one has very strict criteria, but yet the civic one, I guess you answer everything based on the application. I think that should be consistent also. Informative.
Anyone else? Vote. All those in favor of item D, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item E, consider and take possible action regarding approving a new administrative cabinet level position for Assistant Superintendent for Post-Secondary Education and Career Readiness. Do I have a motion? Motion by Mr. Macias, second by Mr. Salinas. Discussion.
Yeah.
Mr. Macias.
Yes. Dr. Montoya, thank you for bringing this to the board. I know that you've been here how long now? 2 years? 3 years? Well, again, I do agree.
This week, not like 2 years.
Well, our duration. I will say that I appreciate your leadership, and I know that you're getting your feet wet and you're looking at the district. So tell me a little bit of why this is going to be a home run for us. What's your thought on that?
We have a need, in my opinion, in this district to go to a higher level opportunity for our students. What's out there beyond the high school? What's out there in colleges? What's out there in universities? What opportunities? What scholarships? What kinds of career areas are there for certificates? Right now, it's very fragmented. We have about 7 or 8 employees doing pieces all over the place. And I think another piece here was what opened it was when Ms. Michelle said, we have athletes that we're not sure if the procedure for getting scholarships for colleges is correct. And as we analyze that piece, we discovered there's like 5 or 6 groups trying to address that. this position would allow us to bring all of this under one board, one person, one department, and to expand the scholarship opportunities only for athletes, but for others, and to have the opportunity to visit with several universities in the nearby, you know, we're lucky here in Austin and San Antonio that we have numerous universities and community colleges that are very good, but we don't really have a system to do that. We have one person sometimes goes to a meeting, sometimes they don't, and you know, it depends on who I assign. This would be that type of position to help us in improving the whole college world for our kids, as well as some of the career readiness areas.
And I see that this is probably an outcome of House Bill 5.
And also House Bill 5, correct. The state has asked in the last year and a half school districts in Texas to expand these areas and to develop positions, to develop activities to support students in the post-secondary and career readiness area, correct.
I just have one follow-up question. And this is just for perspective for my colleagues as well as for the community. How is that being handled right now? Who's doing what?
We have about 8 departments doing pieces. We have counselors, 3 different types of counselors. Some are regular counselors, some are career counselors. We have coaches trying to do it. We have the district athletic director trying to do this. We have a career technology director. So right now, it's very fragmented. We need to do it better to help our kids have these opportunities.
Yes, sir, thank you. Dr. Montoya, I recall when I first came, you got here before I did, but when I first came, I asked you, tell me what it is that you're bringing to our district. What is your forte that you're bringing to our district? And you spoke very highly of how where you came from, all of the high schools there were early college high schools, and that was what you wanted to lend your particular expertise to our district. Well, we do have 1 early college high school. And so that was successfully opened by whomever successfully opened it. It was opened. And some of the cabinet members who are still here were here at that time. So my question is, if you knew then that that was going to be one of your goals, why are you just now telling the board now about a new cabinet decision?
Let me go in reverse. In another district I was at, we made all of our high schools early college. What early college means is that kids get college credits in high school. That means they get the high school diploma plus so many college hours all the way up to an associate. But so whenever we use the phrase early college, that's what that means. So the answer is, I wanted to see what was going on in the district because I've only been here a few months. I needed to analyze and see. And in the other district, I actually had a similar position, different title, but basically the same position with a person that was doing this, working with principals, with me as the superintendent, and with a whole big picture to develop this. And I truly believe we can do early college and high schools in Judson. You know, that's what the missing piece. Plus, there's another piece that we need to look at STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. We have that at the middle school. It's a very good program, but we have none in directly targeting that at the high school. And this position will also help us expand that and do some things. So there's a lot of components. And again, respectfully, we need to do better with some of our athletes instead of this fragmented, somebody said this, somebody said that. No, we didn't. And I think we can do it better.
Okay. Well, sir, let me ask you another question. Because if you're going to add another position, then I'd like to know where are you going to, if we're going to add a new position, that's a new cost.
Mm-hmm.
where are you going to subtract? You can't add it when you're not subtracting. We're going to be asking taxpayers to go out for a bond. You have already moved one of your employees from one position and added another position in child nutrition that was not there before. And so now you're talking about adding another cabinet here.
Number one, the food service position had been there. It just had been structured different. So if it had been there, it had been done different. Number two, and now I'm going to preach a little bit here. This is a growing district. It's growing. We have a little over 23,000 students, almost 3,000 employees. We are growing at the rate of about 3% a year. That is one of the reasons why we're asking the public for a bond. When you grow at that rate, you get increased students and you increase funding from the state. Because remember, we get funded by the state per student. Number one on enrollment and number two on attendance. So the money for this position would come literally from the growth itself. Because we're going to need some of these positions, and there'll be others in the future. As we grow, we have to have positions. Example, the new high school. We're going to have some positions there, but it's also based on growth and student population coming in, and the state funding is from that perspective.
Yes, sir. When you're talking about an administration, that's my concern, that you're talking about another cabinet member. I venture to say that you have your second in command, Ms. Berry, that could do this. That all of these programs that you're referring to, aren't there already directors in those particular programs?
Not all of them. We have specialists. We have, I guess, like lead teachers. We have different positions. And some, yes, are under director. But I believe, folks, that as this district grows, and it is growing, and as we get funding from the state, this is a very important position to help our kids achieve that higher level, college access, career access. We need this centralized. That's my opinion.
Yes, sir. And I would totally agree with all of that. I just don't agree with having another cabinet member in order to make that happen. I believe that you have someone, your second in command, that could do this.
I think Ms. Bell does a good job, but she has numerous, numerous duties. If you looked at the organizational chart that I furnished you, you would see all the assignments and all the extra things they're doing. My opinion, respectful.
Yes, sir. I'm not going to support this.
Mr. LaFleur.
Excuse
me, where's my voice? How soon are you looking at putting this into effect?
Officially this coming summer. And that gives us the next few months to see who the right person is. Because in the middle of the year, it's hard to hire an education, a quality person. Usually it's better that you hire them at the end of the school year because the superintendent's on the lease.
Do you have anybody in mind?
I have several people in mind that are out there that are doing a great job helping students achieve college dreams and hopes. And so the answer is I have some ideas, but we'll see how that pans out.
Mr. Salinas.
Thank you, Mr. Flores. Dr. Montoya, I know you came in and you gave us the first 100 days. To learn the district and see what things needed to be done so you could continue to move on and make our district better. I am glad to see this job description is not a wishy-washy. You put it, and I've told you, and I've told these board members and some of these cabinet members, I do read job descriptions. You didn't put there preferred doctorate in education. You put required.
That's correct.
And I appreciate that. We're not going to be wishy-washy.
That's correct.
The other thing that you've been talking about is, yes, we have one early college. No, I want more than one. I want Jackson High School, I want Wagner High School, and why not the new high school? And I appreciate that. That's where we're going to move forward. And not just make it available for, oh, yes, what if I missed it because I was always away or something more, I could make it to Jacob. Well, I'm sorry, you're moving in the right direction. I would be approving this. It's very important. It's for the students. It's going to involve a lot of students. And I said, I will spend money if it's going to be something that's going to involve the students' future. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Dr. Felina.
I'm going to have to push my buttons here because some people have already asked my questions. Glad to see that the start date is not until the summer because we will have some monies free up June of 2016. Also, I really want to focus on the accountability piece. So we have four indices now that we're rated on, and I believe it's index four, Ms. Austin, is all about college career readiness, which is very difficult because it's not just high school, it's K-12. And I didn't see in the job description where it listed a grade level or I can see what it says, so I know that it's K-12. I personally would like to see a little K-12 piece added to that because so that it's not just for high schools. And having been a former principal here in the district on the south side of the district, I think JECA is awesome. I think it's a great opportunity, but there are inequities. Not everybody from Kirby has an opportunity, and they only take a select few. And it's about how you interview, and it's about how you write. And so I'm all about, like I said, accountability. I think this will help Index 4. I think it will also help get rid of some of the inequities that are there, I know they're not there on purpose, but they exist. And so I think this will help.
Dr. Montoya, I can understand one position that you're talking about, but one position's not going to be able to handle all of that stuff. What kind of staff do you think you're looking at?
We would probably assign a secretarial administrative assistant. That's what the thing would need. And we may have, we have several out there that are joint working in several departments already as a model. So we could do that. But this position would work from that position in the sense of we've already contacted several universities, and it's important that we have a person, and I'm going to say it here, it's important that we have a doctoral person sitting with a doctoral university person at the same level, because that allows us to do this better and more effectively.
But one person will not be able to do everything,
Well, there's some of these other positions, we would reorganize the chart.
Yeah, perfect.
And some of these would fall better in walking into this position.
I agree with Mr. Felina on this is going to help the students in the long run, and it will help the district. Mr. Shaw.
One last thing, but what you were just saying, Dr. Montoya, isn't that what you would be doing, overseeing?
I oversee, obviously, the whole district. So this would be one position. I oversee curriculum. I oversee administration. I oversee. So this would be one position under me. So, yes, I would oversee the whole district. That's the job of the superintendent.
Have you explored anyone in your cabinet that you thought of?
I looked internally and I've looked externally, but internally we have a tight cabinet, a smaller cabinet for this size school district. And some of them feel like they have a lot of things they're doing, and we want them to do it well. We don't want to give them extra duties and assign them an assignment. We want to find the right person to be able to do this correctly to help our kids.
Any other discussion?
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Mr. Shaw may. Motion carries. Item F. Consider and take possible action regarding approving the personnel report and updates, including new hires, resignations, and administrative appointments. Do we need to go to closed session? Okay, then we're just going to go to closed session for everything that we have here. Just stay in there. Yes, yes. Item A, pursuant to Texas Government Code 551.071 and 551.072, consultation with legal counsel and deliberations concerning the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property. B, pursuant to Texas Government Code 551.071, attorney consultation, legal issues related to possible termination and unpaid suspension of Wagner High School band director and related personnel matters. C, pursuant to Texas Government Code Section 551.074, consider and discuss possible termination and unpaid suspension of Wagner High School band director. D, pursuant to Texas Government Code Section 551.074, consider and discuss possible employment and duties of term contract employees. E, pursuant to Texas Government Code 551.074, discussing personnel. We're going to go into closed session at 10:23. No final action, decision, or vote shall be taken while the board is in closed session. The board shall reconvene the open meeting after the closed session. And if necessary, any vote or decision will be made in open session prior to adjourning the meeting.